is subject to fluctuations. Domestic, the industrialization and growth based on the domestic demand. It is the poor's income. If income goes in the hand of a poor, they will demand more food, they will demand more consumer item, they will demand more cloth, they will demand more health and education. So increasing the domestic demand of by the poor and lower middle class and middle class through an increased income is the is a major source and instrument of growth which we have to realize. I think, and then there has to be certain policies for those who suffer from discrimination. If the private sectors, we find some discrimination faced by female, some discrimination faced by scheduled caste, with equal qualification they face discrimination, then there has to be some affirmative action policy that is to have some preference to them in employment, which private sector has accepted, by the way. You must understand that. The private sector has affirmative action policy, CIA, Confederation of Industries and FICCI. They have affirmative action policy of 4 years. It is accepted. But what I am trying to share with you is the present state of knowledge and some empirical evidence from India. I would like to conclude by saying that I think we must understand this concept of inclusive growth and poor growth properly. Otherwise we have a tendency to mold it. It is not the radical economies, it is the World Bank, which believe in mainstream economies and mainstream model of growth. It has changed its position from growth alone to the inclusive growth and to poor growth. And therefore, our plan also accepted, 11th plan and 12th plan, clearly accepted that we will have our plan based on the inclusive growth, pro-poor growth. And they also accept the non-discriminatory growth, that we will focus more on the wage laborer, we will focus more on scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, religious minority like Muslim, we will focus more on gender, we have that. But now I do not know whether we don't have a 13th plan, we don't know the economic policies, whether the same inclusive model which we accepted in 12th plan is being carried or not, we do not know really. We cannot create a new knowledge and new view on this. The shifting from growth alone to the poor growth and non-discriminatory growth is based on the experience of the several countries in the world, and we have arrived at that stage, and we should accept it and we should implement it. And both state and the market has a role in it. The role of the state is identified, role of the market is identified. How much freedom private sector need, that is also important. To be able to give them freedom to invest and make decisions easily. Friends, these are some of the thoughts that I wanted to share with you. I am very grateful to you, thankful to you that you have invited me and allow me to share my thought before this very exim audience. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Thorat. The brief of what sir has spoken, I'll just say a few words. He spoke on the theory of inequality, the mainstreaming of economic growth as the World Bank model. He spoke on Human Development Index and the parameters that have to be understood and underlined by the policy makers, the international literature on growth, recent trends in understanding how the countries are defining the growth patterns, and relation between the economic growth and social structure, which has been a very important factor, and challenges for the industry in promoting the growth patterns. I think these have been the key things which Professor Thorat has highlighted. May I throw the floor open for questions, please?
Yeah, good afternoon. Professor Thorat has very nicely explained the concept of growth and the changing trends. I have two points, sir. If the poor do not have access to the assets, why government is wasting money on populist policies instead of creating assets for them? That's question number one. Question number two, while the idea of affirmative action is very valid and relevant, how are we aligning that with creamy layers? So these are two questions, sir. My name is Surendra Reddy. I'm Dean in Srinidhi Institute of Science and Technology. Thank you.
Sir, With regard to the growth in economy, no matter how much growth takes place in the economy as well as in the income, it is only linear growth. Whereas the growth in population has been exponential. Now, if steps are not taken to limit the growth in population, even if you have 20% growth in GDP, it's not going to reach all the people. So where is the law which says not more than 2 children per family? That's the first one. Second thing is, no matter how much growth there is, what about the quality of life? One is not even able to cross the road at a designated pedestrian crossing without getting a heart attack or without getting run over. Thank you.
One side we are talking about our growth is increasing and our production has really increased and everything is okay. But another side,
I didn't say everything is okay.
No, sir. So when we are talking about the welfare programs also, India is having so many of the welfare programs to improve the nutritional status, to decrease the poverty and all the other things. But when you are just talking about, even we have not reached or achieved the Millennium Development Goals, or in spite of all the other things, and we have got good policies also. I want to have the clarity how best we can proceed to improve our nutritional status or to reduce the malnutrition or to reduce the poverty in spite of all the growth or maybe the production, agriculture, or our intellectual capacity is also increasing. Thank you, sir.
Sir, you were talking about the pro-poor growth as the increase in growth of per capita income of the poor people. But we have only one national average, that is national income divided by population is the per capita income. Are we measuring the per capita incomes of the various categories, like rich people per capita income, middle class income people per capita income? Do we have such basic data? Or how do you measure that, sir, like pro-poor growth or not? And second thing is, when you are talking about the opportunities for SCST and backward class people, why the government is not, considering the, foregoing of reserved category for the people who have already availed the reservations for the last two or three generations, and then they are now in the upper strata of the society? And why their children are continue to enjoy this reservation?
I congratulate Professor Thorat for a very nice lecture. My question is with regard to this corporate governance and board composition, because many business people are sitting here. We see that most of the time the board composition in the businesses doesn't represent the women or maybe SC, ST minorities. With the result, now that liberalization of FDI has come, and in most of the sectors, 49 to 100%. So with the implication of this liberalized FDI in the corporates and then board composition, what is the reason that we are not having participation of the women and SC, STs in the board composition? And the influence of it is on the inclusive growth also. And second is with regard to size of the state. Now we have Telangana state. You know, compared to that of Bihar and state like UP, you know, smaller states will have a better growth prospects from the state perspective and better rural economic growth than that of a larger population growth. I would like to know from you about it. Thank you very much.
I think the reservation policy and financial support to the minorities and other categories, is it sufficient for them to empower and to take jobs in the private sector? Our government should do something.
So that is a common theme which has appeared in 2-3 questions. Now, but first question was by Surinder Reddy was, what do we do about the asset? The redistribution of asset and say land, we have tried to land reform measure in the 50s and the 60s, but the redistribution was much less. As a result, we have a problem of landlessness to a greater extent, particularly among the scheduled castes, not as much among the scheduled tribe or OBC. at all India level of the total rural household belonging to scheduled caste, 65% are wage laborer. Only 40% of them have some land. So we tried as far as the land is concerned. As regard the capital and access to ownership of enterprises and capital, well, there are efforts on the part of the government for both for scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, the JCST Finance Corporation, which provide the fund, the affirmative action policy of the corporate sector, CII, FICCI, and Associate Chamber of Commerce, promoting enterprises is one of the policies. So there is a focus on increasing the asset, but it's a very limited focus. I would say that we have to give a serious thought about enterprises, improving the access to the enterprises. One way is obviously very simple, that for increasing the access to capital and enable the people to start the private enterprise or business, have a affirmative action policy in giving licenses more to the scheduled caste and poor, give them credit, give them the infrastructure facility like water, electricity, land on a priority basis, and increase the number of the self-employed, which is being used in India as well as in South Africa and other countries like Malaysia. But in this policy of increasing the ownership of private enterprise and business and access to capital, the very small section normally benefits because it requires capabilities, it requires leadership, it requires enterprises. The affirmative action policy of the private sector train the people from the social background like scheduled caste, scheduled tribe in entrepreneurship development. But very extremely few manage because it's a skill which one has to earn over a period of time. But you look at Malaysia and South Africa, Malaysia particularly, how did they handle their problem of lack of capital? Malaysia had the discriminated community called Malayas, which is the majority community, 60% population. But the dominant is Chinese and Indian, who own the industries. So in 1970, there was a big riot, as has been pointed out by Madhurao, huge conflict, several people killed. So Malaysia brought a new policy of empowering the Malayas. And what did they do? There are several things. I don't want to go into that, but I just want to give you one example, and, you know, leader of the industries are here. What they have done, Malaysia had done, that they identified the poor section of Malayas, particularly Malayas, and they say that every private industry and foreign industry, not only private industry, foreign industry, will have within a period of 20 years 30% share to be won by Malayas. It's a simple method. It's not developing entrepreneurship. So what they did, they set up a public trust by the government, put thousands of crore of their own currency, and also asked the Malayas, poor Malayas, to put some deposit. And out of that fund, they buy the share and debenture for these poor people. And this is assured income, almost an assured income. And that is how you get access to the capital, and there is a income in your hand. And secondly, the question raised by the Vice Chancellor is that they also get into the board. Once you are a shareholder, you also get into the board and you get to know what is the employment composition of the factory. Are there enough of Malaya? You can raise the question. I think we must try this approach. For example, now, 2% of the profit of every company has to go to corporate social responsibility. My suggestion would be that let the corporate sector benefit out of their own policy. Out of their 2%, they can spend some 20% enabling to buy the share of their own company by the poor and give them the benefit of their return. And they are very easy because starting entrepreneurship is a very difficult job. But by making the poor people buy shares and making it eligible to the income gain is a relatively easy thing. And the corporate sector benefit here. Their own money come back to them in the form of a share. But we have to apply this mind. As far as the board is concerned, I agree with you. There are a couple of articles by the Canadian scholars that the ownership of the boards of the companies is highly dominated by the traditional business communities and high caste, and there are hardly any people. Now this is first. Then somebody, the second question was the population growth. We have a population policy. Who says that we don't have a population policy? We had a very aggressive policy. Even today we have an aggressive policy and our population growth rate has declined substantially. But despite the higher population growth rate, our income growth rate has been much higher. As a result, our per capita income has increased. During the 2004 and 2011, when our income increases by 9% and population growth rate is about 1.9 or something, so several times more than the population growth rate, as a result our per capita income increases and it helped to reduce the poverty. So I think we are aware about the population growth rate. I am not saying that we are not, and we have a population policy. Quality of life is right, but quality of life is also we are aware. I mean, this question is raised by here also, that whatever market can take, whatever growth can take, employment, income of the poor, okay. But income, increase in the income has a limitation, so government comes in, and government has then public education institution, several health scheme, health insurance, several scheme for housing, Indira Awas Yojana and other. So what market cannot do, state has to do. Through the social protection policy, and we have those social protection policy, highly focusing on the poor. So that is what we say, that market and state will combine. What market can do, allow the market to do, and what market cannot do, then the state through the tax revenue takes special scheme for the poor. Then somebody asked that where is the income data for the lower middle class and income class. Madam, there is a data, monthly per capita consumption expenditure data can be arranged according to the decile. You can take the population, entire population, and first decile, second decile, third decile.